These are your listener-supported radio stations, KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno.
And online?
And online at kpfa.org.
Welcome to Pushing Limits. I'm your host, Shelley Berman. Today we're going to talk about what happens when people with disabilities hang out together. Stephanie Sugars, the facilitator of an international grassroots support group, wanted to build a cyber inn where people could come together and gather around the fire to share stories. We'll talk about that inn, the Peutz-Jeghers Inn, later in the show. But we're going to start out with some folks you met in our last program, Blind Man's Bluff, the true story of a woman who slowly loses her sight as she finds friends and a resistance movement. We begin as our shero, Geri Taekens, arrives for a job interview at the local independent living center.
I was extremely nervous when I went to my job interview at the Center for Disability Relations. In a wheelchair.
Hi, I'm Nina, the director. You must be Geri. We're going to the conference room. The rest of the staff will meet us there. You can have a seat right here. Why don't we introduce ourselves?
Hey there, Geri. I'm Cheryl. I know you can't see me, but I'm a wheelchair user like Nina. It'd probably be more effort than it's worth to try and shake hands. So, I'll just tell you that I'm also very beautiful. Come on, guys. You gotta let me take a little advantage of her. It's not every day I get to convince someone of my gorgeous looks.
Nice to meet you. Who else do we have in the room?
Don't believe her, Geri. She is gorgeous. I'm Mike. I use a wheelchair, too. If you could see me, you'd know I'm not gorgeous, as my arthritis has bent me up a bit. Don't go worrying about it, though. I still know how to swing, and my girlfriend ain't got no problem with my weird positioning. It works better in bed, you know?
Oh, my God.
Well, I'm glad you found a good use for your situation.
Well, Geri, we're awfully glad you applied for the social work position. You certainly have an excellent resume. So we'd like to start by asking what you can bring to a center that is set up to assist people with accepting their physical and mental disabilities.
I'm just starting to accept myself. How can I tell them I can do anything for anyone else? I guess I can offer understanding and empathy. The fact that I have been through a lifetime of trying to accept my growing blindness would be my greatest asset.
That's good.
I've been losing my vision since at least age 7. I've struggled a lot with denial and tried to pretend I could see more than I really could.
Oh, yeah.
I have to admit, it's only been in the past few years that I've been willing to acknowledge the likelihood I will go totally blind.
Sounds familiar. Of course, the loss of my mobility went to a little faster than yours.
Oh, really?
Yeah, my rheumatoid arthritis hit when I was 16. I was on my high school gymnastics team, and I remember forcing myself to get out on the gym floor, even though I wouldn't be able to move for the rest of the day. By age 17, I got so I couldn't move at all.
Bummer. Careful, Geri. Don't be overly sympathetic.
Not sure what would be better, having some adjustment time or having it happen all at once. In my case, I didn't have a choice. I got hit by a drunk driver in an oncoming car.
No kidding. Boy, that's too bad.
I hold no grudges. Can't waste my time with that nonsense. It could have been me just as easily as the 18-year-old guy who hit me. Heck, I was a little bum myself when I got hit. Probably kept me alive, because my muscles were pretty relaxed at the time. The doc said if I'd been totally sober, my body might have been more rigid, resisting the impact and causing my spinal cord to snap up higher. As it is, I only have paralysis from the nipples down instead of needing a breathing machine for the rest of my life, or not needing nothing at all.
So you're recommending we all be a little drunk when riding in a car?
You got it, girl. This one's a keeper, Nina. You're all right, Geri.
Gee, thanks. So with your accident happening so fast like that, do you think it might have been easier to adjust better with no opportunity to deny the truth?
Don't get me wrong. It ain't been easy, and denial exists even when the facts are clear. For a long time, I kept thinking the feeling in my body might come back, or they'd come up with some kind of operation to just reconnect my spinal cord. Actually, I did start to get some sensation in my arms and some patches on my stomach. When that happened, I really took off on this "I'm going to be cured" kick, holding on to the sensations as proof that I would get better. But when I finally realized that was about the extent of my recovery, physical recovery that is, my real recovery began.
What do you mean?
I mean, my mind had to recover from the truth about my situation. I had to get angry, cry, beg, bargain with God, and fall into a hopeless depression before I could even get on with it. Took me 2 years to finally get to the point where I'll accept adaptive devices for writing, eating, drinking, and showing myself in public.
So you feel pretty accepting of your situation now?
Fairly much. Don't get me wrong. I still wish I could walk or get myself dressed in the morning and no nonsense like that. But I am no longer ashamed of who I am. I have my brain, my wonderful personality, and I'm a good lover. What's the matter? Don't tell me you're like the rest of the world who think trips don't get no sexual desires and abilities.
No, I just wasn't expecting to hear about everyone's sex lives at my interview.
Oh, we do have a unique group here.
Well, like I said, this one's a keeper.
What experiences do you have working with people who have been newly disabled?
I spent one of my social work internships at a rehab hospital in Detroit. I had to counsel and make discharge plans for people before they went home.
What types of disabilities?
Oh, lots of different situations. One man had been shot in the head, which resulted in a brain injury. Several folks had spinal cord injuries. And I worked with a few people with post-polio syndrome.
Really? I have that, you know. I was an early bloomer, and at the time, medical people weren't acknowledging that syndrome too readily.
Yeah, I talked to a lot of people who were told their pain was in their head, or that nothing could be done for them.
What about your experience with people with mental illnesses?
What should I share? Living with my ex and his mental illness gave me plenty of experience, but how far will the honesty and openness of this group go? I'll just dip my toe into the water.
Mental illness is likely the least accepted, least understood, and most isolating disorder around. People need adjustment counseling and peer support, and one of my dreams is to help develop these programs.
Sounds like we're all in luck today. The grant that's letting us hire another staff person requires us to set up programs to address psychiatric deinstitutionalization.
Geri, your paratransit ride is here.
We certainly are impressed with all you've had to say here today, Geri.
Thank you. I'm impressed as well. I've never been interviewed and had so much fun.
Well, we should know by next week sometime if the grant funding comes through. If it does, I believe the staff and I are very interested in bringing you on board.
Thank you very much.
Come on, ma'am. Get on the bus. I have 3 more pickups and I'm running late.
You know what? I'm disabled. It takes me a little longer, and that's just fine.
You're listening to Pushing Limits, KPFA's disability program. The scene you just heard was adapted from Blind Man's Bluff, a memoir by Geri Taekens. Geri Taekens was played by Kris Yates. Leah Gardner played Nina. Cheryl was played by Mary Ann Tidwell Broussard. Doyle Saylor was Mike. Jan Santos did the intercom voice. And Patty Nash was the wonderful, marvelous, grumpy bus driver. Lamont Young was our recording engineer. Leah Gardner and myself, Shelley Berman, directed the recording. Adrienne Lauby adapted the script and edited the audio and sound effects. Thanks to the Shoestring Radio Theater for sound effect assistance. If you want to know what happens to Geri after she gets the job, go to Geri Taekens' website, isahealthfundallonword.org. Buy a copy of her memoir, Blind Man's Bluff, and help raise money for health care for service animals. You can find it locally at Walden Pond Books, the oldest independent bookstore in Oakland, or through the usual online booksellers. What you just heard was a brief encounter with disability culture, one form of it, in one time and place. We continue the show with Adrienne Lauby talking to Stephanie Sugars about a very different experience of disability culture.
I want to be the innkeeper that keeps the inn where people come and gather around the fire and tell stories.
That's Stephanie Sugars, who facilitates a large e-group of 250 to 300 people who live with a rare genetic disease called Peutz-Jeghers Syndrome. The Peutz-Jeghers group is celebrating its 10-year anniversary this month. Petra Cuppers of Olympia's Performance says that disability is such an embattled place that to even call for something like disability culture is a form of utopia, to call for something that's not quite there. Petra's right, but there is something there in the Peutz-Jeghers cyber group. And let's face it, our community is riddled with support groups. Deaf and blind folks pioneered them in the early 1800s with boarding school friendships and adult social clubs. By the middle of the 19th century, groups like the League of the Physically Handicapped and the Paralyzed Veterans of America began. And parents started organizations like the National Association for Retarded Children and the United Cerebral Palsy Association. Then in the 70s, inspired by civil rights and the anti-war activism, the independent living movement championed peer groups with a strong political action mission. Then there's therapy. Well, all of this is before the internet. Stephanie is here to talk about one support group, the Peutz-Jeghers Syndrome e-group, its internal culture, how she steers clear of flame wars, and what this community is talking about these days. So, Stephanie, what is Peutz-Jeghers?
Peutz-Jeghers Syndrome affects every cell in the body, but mainly manifests as three classical hallmarks, and I would add a fourth hallmark: pigmentation or freckles on the lips and other body parts, places that they aren't usually found, a polyposis of the GI tract with the polyps that can be spread from the esophagus through the colon, but primarily in the small bowel, and an increased risk of cancer up to 85%. The fourth hallmark that I would add are reproductive tract tumors that affect most women and significant number of the males that have it.
And how do people get this disease?
It's a rare genetic disorder, not sex-linked. If a person has it, each of their children, if they procreate, has a 50% chance of getting it. Oddly enough, in Peutz-Jeghers, about 50% of us have the first genetic mutation in our family. But then each of our children, if we procreate, will have a 50% chance of getting the genetic disorder.
So it's 10 years of this support group. Happy anniversary. That's an incredible achievement. Why, when you started out, did you not form sort of a traditional medical nonprofit? Why did you decide to go with something so basically simple?
The metaphor I used was, I want to be the innkeeper that keeps the inn where people come and gather around the fire and tell stories, a place where people can really share what is in their hearts and minds. It's so nourishing and nurturing to work directly with people who are affected. I have managed nonprofits in the past, and I have a pretty clear idea of what that is and how that works. I really didn't want to go to money-based organization. I, at the time, was very concerned about how many patient organizations were funded by especially drug companies or corporations with a vested interest in those populations, and I didn't want to have the logo of a drug manufacturer on what I distributed. I also really believe in the power of people and the grassroots and the importance of people connecting one with another and not going through the hierarchy to do it. And I didn't want to put myself in a place of hierarchy.
So a lot of times people set up these little inns, and what comes is a lot of brawling, a lot of flaming and spamming.
I'll start with spamming. That has been remarkably easy because we're sponsored by ACOR, or Association of Cancer Online Resources Incorporated. It's a nonprofit that sponsors over 100 cancer-related online support groups or mailing lists. It's pretty clean space and it's pretty well run. Then the flame wars is an interesting thing. We have an amazing culture of kindness and consideration. In fact, we've never had a flame war in 10 years. Without getting too woo-woo or spiritual, I think that it's really born of compassion. Pretty much anybody that wants to join our group has really, really suffered, either their own in their own physical body or their child or their partner.
My experience is that people who have suffered, it's kind of a mixed bag because some people are wounded and not healed from that, and they can be very cruel in their woundedness. So I'm wondering, are you woo-woo?
Yes, people that are very hurt can be very mean. Why? Maybe it's part of our genetic defect.
We've got a kindness gene.
It's really been very minimal when someone's found a miracle product that they want everybody to take. And I say, speak from your experience. I'm very open to alternatives, but speak from your experience, not from the advertising brochure. Somebody chose not to have children. Somebody else interpreted that as being pro-abortion. Take it out. Don't go there. Don't do that. The other problem that often happens with online support groups is misinformation. I am really on it as the list owner. I know the research. So if somebody comes and says something that I think, that's really off, did they understand their doctor correctly? I'll often not call people out. That doesn't start a flame war. I'll often suggest, this is what the research shows. Your doctor's saying this thing, but it doesn't really make sense. Do you feel okay about asking your doctor if this is what he or she really meant?
You're listening to Pushing Limits, KPFA's disability program. Adrienne Lauby is talking to Stephanie Sugars, the facilitator of a large e-group of people living with the genetic disease Peutz-Jeghers Syndrome. She just asked Stephanie what kinds of things come up in the group.
People think first actually about their children and their children's well-being, whether that's when they, an affected person, is thinking about family planning and using reproductive technologies, or how their child's going to grow up, what technologies are coming that will help them. People care a lot about getting an early, correct diagnosis and the best possible treatment, where that's affordable for them. They care a lot about the technologies. We keep each other informed from Germany, Japan, Australia, United States, really across cultural borders, what's coming up. We have many members whose doctors are pioneering new techniques. So our members will write about the techniques long before it ever hits the medical journals.
How much of your time do you spend on this?
It really varies because I read the literature and I think about it. So you could say all the time. Right now I've got a pile of literature on my desk that I'm walking around thinking about, oh, this new study about cancer risk. Oh, this new technology. Oh, this new finding about our gene. Oh, what are the bioethics of reproductive technologies? So sort of all the time, but I can't really bring myself to spend more than maybe an hour a day in front of the computer.
Say a little bit more about the culture of this inn that you've established. What is the culture?
April 30th, 2000 was our very first post, so it's totally great that we're going on the radio on April 30th, 2010. It's evolved from a very small group of people. The evolution that I've seen in the group is that there is a culture of caring. There's a culture of kindness. There's a culture of commiseration, because sometimes you can't do something to change somebody's reality, but sometimes you can. Sometimes you can provide the missing link, just the bit of information or the bit of confidence in them that allows them perhaps to go back to their doctor or to try a second opinion, to do something different, or to make a lifestyle change that they know is in their own benefit. The children are a big motivator for a lot of the members. Our active members are mostly from their 20s to their 60s. This culture of kindness and caring is also the hope for the future, the hope that the children do not have to suffer as much as we had to suffer. Certainly as the technologies advance, things that have been done to us aren't being done to them. It's difficult for the adults in the group when the children are still suffering, especially because of misdiagnosis, undiagnosis, underdiagnosis, mistreatment, or even good treatment that's bad.
People die, and people that people know on the list die. How does this community handle that?
It's very difficult. It depends on how much we identify with the person, I think, how much we feel, wow, that person's disease process was just like mine, or I have a geographically similar situation, or that's how my mom died too, or I really loved this person. We've had some very loved and highly esteemed members who've passed. There's the personal reaction to it, and then there's the group reaction, and it really does send out shock waves through the group. If there are family members or caregivers who are still associated with the group, the letters of condolence and support are extremely loving and warm, but it will cause some people to clam up and some people to even leave the list perhaps for a while and then come back.
And how about class differences with such high and exotic medical treatments? And you're international, right? What's the range of people's differences?
Well, everything from my favorite family in the Philippines, whose father died recently because he could get no medical care. He died of cancer. He's got two teenage daughters being raised by a mom who can't afford to get the teenage daughters the medical care they need. So absolute zero accessibility. Then we have people in the UK who are perhaps denied pancreatic cancer screening, but their polyps are dealt with. And then in the U.S., we have a tremendous, tremendous class difference where the haves really can get, if they can find it, the kind of help that they need. But the have-nots are often in and out of ER rooms or just living lives of quiet desperation. I know of a number of people that basically give up on the system, and I have done that periodically in my life. It's difficult. I mentioned there the haves and the have-nots. We have a number of members who are permanently disabled, living on Social Security, and get medical benefits through that. They actually have better access to better medical care than people who are middle class, still struggling, employed, are underinsured, or adequately insured, but with high deductibles, high copays, and numerous, numerous procedures. Now, as I'm saying this, it's almost like there's a tier system. The haves that have great insurance and extra money to buy extra services. The people who are struggling in the middle because they're underinsured, the people who are uninsured and having to go to the ERs, and then the people who have just said, I give up, I'm disabled, I'm going out on disability, and then have some level of medical care, be it Medicaid or Medicare or both.
Do you have a sense of how the Obama health care reform may or may not change that situation?
I really think it's too soon to say.
So many nonprofits right now are struggling with leadership and transitions from generations of activists. How do you see that playing out here?
I'm very concerned if I go that there won't be someone as conscientious about bringing literature forward and really making sure that people are getting and giving the right information, because it's so easy to spread misinformation. And I'm very hopeful that we have built a culture that people can give each other support. There are topics that will come up already in the group that I don't need to respond to at all, because I know that there are people, 20 different people who might respond, and maybe four will. But for the person that wrote the letter, that's good enough. They don't need me.
When we're sitting around the fire with whoever happens to be there in that period of time, and the question of abortion and what happens when your children may be born with the disease, what kind of conversation happens?
It's very painful. It's very painstaking, and we go very slowly and we're very gentle with one another. How do you say, I don't want to have a child that has the same disease I have? That's almost erasing yourself. It's almost like saying, my life is not worth living. I wouldn't give that to a child. or I would. I think in this day and age, when reproductive technologies become more and more prevalent in society, it will become almost criminal in some people's minds for someone that's affected by one of these rare disorders, or even an unrare disorder, to go ahead and have a child that has a 50-50 chance of having that disorder. It will almost be like child abuse before the fact. How could you do that to somebody? You know what your childhood was like, and we can say, oh, well, I'm going to gamble that the technologies will improve, that there'll be a cure, but it's kind of really a gamble. And nobody wants to tell anybody else what to do. They really try to speak from their own experience and understanding. And there are a number of us group members who've had voluntary sterilization or chosen not to have children or been infertile. That's a whole different part because of the reproductive tract tumors. A lot of us are infertile.
Are there people who have chosen to have children and then have children who have the syndrome and are happy with their decision, and do they speak?
Oh, absolutely. And there are people who are now young adults or adults whose parents perhaps were guilt-ridden and will say, I am so glad I'm alive. And even, I am glad I'm alive and have had this experience in my life. And I don't want to make it into a big rosy picture. I know that there are also members who say, I wish I'd never been born.
Is there anything else you'd like to say?
My personal hope for the coming decade is that patients with all types of health challenges that are used to working in and with the medical profession continue to support each other, but continue to bring our issues out into the larger public discourse. When I read medical literature, it is so dominated by the medical profession, by the researchers, by the drug companies, by the technology developers. It's dominated by interests that aren't necessarily the interests of patients or their families, and I would very much like us to continue to develop a voice to speak on our own behalf and on behalf of each other and to be part of those conversations. Those systems do not exist without patients, and we are put in a subordinate role, a voiceless role, and an unrepresented role. It's not going to get us into a healthy, viable, working, I don't want to say community, but a world. The whole world needs this. It needs awake, aware people, and I hope that patients of whatever stripe continue to talk with each other and take it upon ourselves to bring our issues forward.
How can people either get a hold of you or find this support group?
My email address is the best. It's pj4steph, S-T-E-P-H, at AOL.com. Or you could just Google Peutz-Jeghers Support Group, and hopefully you know how to spell it, and you'll find it. It's, or go to acor.org, A-C-O-R.org.
Thank you.
You can find links to the support group and Stephanie's list of resources for Peutz-Jeghers syndrome on our blog at pushinglimitsradio.blogspot.com. And, oh yes, Peutz-Jeghers is spelled P-E-U-T-Z hyphen J-E-G-H-E-R syndrome. Thanks again to the actors and Stephanie Sugars. Thanks also to Greta Ahert, our engineers, Oscar Hernandez and Josh Elwood, and the entire Pushing Limits gang. Pushing Limits is produced by a collective of people with disabilities. Contact us at 510-848-6767, extension 636, or by email at pushinglimits, all one word, at kpfa.org. I'm Shelley Berman. Thank you for listening. Stay tuned for Open Book.
The Bajaba Showcase Extended presents the Terrific Tuesdays, starting May 1st from 11 p.m. to 12 a.m. here on KPFA Radio. The featured performers will be Matt Duran, multi-reed player, and guitarist Eddie Duran, San Francisco's highly acclaimed jazz duo, known as the most unpretentious jazz couple. This terrific duet will be hosted by Maestro the Doug of Edwards. That's Saturday, May 1st, 11 p.m. on KPFA Radio, 94.1 FM. Please tune in.
These are your listener-supported radio stations, KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno, and online at